Ferrari, Race to Immortality, is a film about humans. It's a human interest story about men and women who put their lives on the line regularly in pursuit of their dreams. It's a film that should appeal to a wide universal audience. It's got danger, it's got excitement, it's got glamour, and it's got everything you kind of hope to see when you go and watch a movie. Well, as a filmmaker, you're always looking for good stories, and in particular, someone who specialises in sport and human interest stories. This one had everything, because every character within this film you could have made a film about individually. But to have the opportunity to put all five characters together and then have Enzo at the top holding them together was too good an opportunity as a filmmaker and a storyteller not to. And it was just so rich with content. I actually had so much content, I was sport for choice. And my difficulty from my side was to home it down and to edit it down and to make a narrative story that had all that integrity and that emotion that these characters lived and portrayed during their existence. You know, the early cuts were long, which is inevitable. And the more we sort of went through the editing process and the more we honed it, the more we crafted the film, I actually don't feel we lost any of the emotional integrity of the story that I wanted to tell. So the duration of the film now and in its final cut, I'm actually very pleased with. There's nothing really left on the cutting room floor that I felt that actually fundamentally it would have made a big difference to the film, either editorial or visually. So I'm actually very pleased with the duration, how it's ended up. Yeah, Enzo's a very complex character, and it was interesting because when I started this project I had a whole different perspective of Enzo as a person than I do now. My whole opinion of Enzo has changed considerably. He was motivated, he was driven, he was focused, but he came from nothing. He had a hard upbringing. He lost his father as a young child, he lost his brother, but he was so self-made and so driven. He knew what he wanted and he went after that. There were obviously lots of side issues with Enzo, and he's got backstories, but like everybody has. Fundamentally, he didn't force anybody to get into his cars. He created this vehicle, he created this racing machine, and drivers wanted to race it. They wanted to get inside the Ferrari and drive it, and he gave them that opportunity. So, unfortunately, there were deaths, a lot of deaths, during the course of it. But Enzo can't really be blamed for that. You know, I wouldn't hold Enzo responsible for that. There were issues. There was talks about disc brakes and issues with some technicalities. But fundamentally, every driver who got into that car chose to get into that car. He didn't force them to. And at the end of the film, I had a real empathy for Enzo as a person. You know, I kind of sat back and think, you know, I just felt much more of empathy for him at the end of the film than I did when we started this project 2 years ago. Why does a driver get into a car? Why push himself to the limit? I mean, fundamentally, you know, they're racers. It's inherently built into their psyche. You put a racing driver in a car, he's going to push it to the limit. Now, whether it was a car, a go-kart, or whatever it might have been, a driver is going to push it to the limit. And I think that's just part of their makeup. That's the difference between a racing driver and just a normal person like me who can drive a car. I could never be a racing driver. And these guys have got something different that sets them apart from the rest of us. You know, what's beautiful about documentary filmmaking is if you've got a true story, if you're starting your process off with a good, true story, then the audience immediately knows that it hasn't been fictionalized, it hasn't been enhanced anyway. What they're seeing is the pure truth of a good story. I love fiction and I love drama, but with a good documentary, there's enough drama rolled into a story such as Race to Immortality that you don't need to fictionalize anything. And that's the beauty of good narrative documentary filmmaking. It's got all the drama you ever could want to or hope to see on the big screen. Yeah, it was a very conscious decision between myself and Julia, the producer, and Paul, the editor, that we wanted to take the viewer back to 1950s and to that decade. So when the film starts, from the opening frame of the film, we transport them back to the decade. And we wanted to hold them into that period and let them stay in that period for 85 minutes. You look and you live and you breathe our racing drivers and their wives and their girlfriends. And so to suddenly reveal them right at the end, visually and editorially, and there's a strong beat within the film, it suddenly brings the audience right the way back to reality, and it's quite a strong conclusion to the film to use that approach and that technique. I would like to think that they, well, first and foremost, I hope they enjoy it and they've got a memorable experience. But I would like to actually bring to a whole new audience, bring back these drivers and these brave men and these, as they were quoted, gladiators from the 50s, who are maybe forgotten and they've been lost in time. But actually, they were pioneers and they set a whole new standard for racing. And I would like to introduce, I'd hopefully bring the memories of these great guys and these great racers back to a whole new generation and a whole new audience.
Well, to be honest, I'm not a great Formula One kind of fanatic like some of the people involved with this film. But when Daryl, you know, explained quite what the human story of some of these amazing drivers of the late 50s was, it just seemed to me that it was a story that had everything. You know, it had romance, it had danger, it had kind of sportsmanship at the highest level, you know, and not just kind of aggressive, competitive sportsmanship, but a real kind of, you know, sportsmanship of an era that's gone now. And I think we were just amazed by the archive and by the fact that some of these drivers seem to have dropped out of the common currency of motor racing history now. I mean, I think you could make a big budget movie of this, and for a while, to be honest, Julia, my fellow producer, and I were flirting with that idea, but it's so difficult really to distill the kind of impact that you have in a documentary where you get this incredible archive. I think one of the films about the film that we've made is that it's full of archive that just feels so resonant of its period. And also you get the testimony of some of the people who were there, who knew these people, who were involved with them, you know, married to them, engaged to them, or following their careers. And there's something terribly moving about people looking back on this period of youth and excitement and danger from you know, much later in their lives. I think what we found when we got the material to the cutting room was that when you listened to the testimony just against the archive, what you felt was that you were really there, you were very vividly absorbed in it. And then the absolutely beautiful effect of seeing people as they are now, when you've been living their lives with them as they were then, back in the late 50s, just seemed to me to give you such a gorgeous moment of sort of emotional resonance that there wasn't really any debate about that. And also, you know, we had so much archive. Why spoil it with people sitting in their studies, however well upholstered? It's been very interesting today, obviously, because Lewis Hamilton, you know, broke the record yesterday and became the, you know, fourth world champion winning British driver, etc., etc. And of course, everyone's saying, well, is he the greatest driver ever? And there was a very good piece by Damon Hill today suggesting that it's almost impossible now to compare in a way, because the technology is so different. The cars were so dangerous then, they're much less dangerous now. And obviously the impact of the team, you know, is probably even more important now than it was back in the Scuderia days of the 50s and 60s. But I think what they all had is, you know, an amazing ability to not only, you know, drive strategically, but also to control the car in a way that became kind of, it's like being a jockey in a way. You know, it's the combination of two very powerful things, you know, man and machine. And driving, as I think somebody says at the time, you know, about Peter Collins driving from muscle memory around the Nürburgring, and you can kind of see that becomes a kind of brilliant piece of athleticism. So yeah, I have added respect, I think, now.
My father collected classic cars and he was a big motor racing fan, and when I was a little girl he showed me pictures of Mike and Peter and I thought they were incredibly glamorous, and told me about this tragic story of their friendship and their loss. And so we were planning to make a feature for quite some time, and then went through various guises over about 7 years. And then when I heard about Michael Mann making his feature, I thought, well, I'd acquired the rights to Mon Ami Mate, so I thought, well, it'd be a good idea to actually make a documentary while he was trying to get his together. And so luckily for us, it's a bit about an 18-month journey of, you know, from starting to film at Goodwood and now finishing the film and it being released. So quite fast in documentary terms. So we were very lucky, and Daryl and I very much shared the same vision of the film, and it's been a fantastic experience. So Well, we were incredibly lucky because we had an amazing researcher in Richard Wiseman, and he trawled the depths of all the archive, and we were very lucky to find some very rare archive that had been shot by Taffy von Trips. Wolfgang von Trips was a great sort of film buff himself and loved to film the drivers at play. He had an 8mm camera and he was always shooting because they were always all following each other around like this big circus, and he shot some amazing behind the scenes, if you like, footage, and we discovered it in this castle in Germany, and that was an amazing thing for us to be able to get such extraordinary archive. And Richard was a big motor racing fan, so it was lucky for us that he knew where to find some of these amazing sources of archive, so it was very lucky. Well, they were incredible characters. I mean, there's no doubt about it. They were five extraordinary men that happened to be driving for the same team and that were tragically, killed in a very short period of time. I think that deaths around that time, there were obviously very many. So it was just an incredible thing that those particular drivers driving for the Scuderia were all killed in such a short space of time, albeit that Mike, obviously, Hawthorn was killed in a road accident, but very shortly after Peter's death. So it just seemed to be an incredible story, and it has a lot of romance and glamour and tragic love story, and we've been very lucky to have contributors, being in the wife of Peter Collins and the fiancée of Mike Hawthorn, and the incredible first-hand accounts that they've provided, and that the stories that they've told us about those amazing men have really, I think, resonated with a female audience. Aside from just the hardcore motor racing fans, women seem to really love the film and get very emotional about these incredible men. I hope they take away the romance and the glamour of these incredible men, and what we wanted to do was to celebrate them. We wanted to bring them to a whole new audience who perhaps weren't aware of them, and I think we've been very successful in doing that. And the feedback about the film has been really incredible, and I think that the larger audience will just really love the adrenaline and the glamour and the tragedy and the romance of it all. So that's what we really wanted to do. So I hope we've been successful in doing that.
Well, I'm sure the imagery is going to be fantastic. So much of its original footage. It's the most exciting time probably of motorsport ever, those sort of mid-50s years. It's very much Goodwood's sweet spot. It's absolutely what the revival's all about. That's, Goodwood operated from 48 to 66. It's absolutely the time that it was in its heyday. Motorsport was at its most, certainly most dangerous and most glamorous. So it should be, a terrific film. Celebrates, obviously, Ferrari in a absolutely fantastic way, and also the wonderful careers of Mike Hawthorn and Peter Collins and their friendship and their time together. So it's going to be, I'm sure, a memorable 90 minutes. Well, see, motor racing is very different then. They didn't get paid anything for starters. They did it for the glory and the sheer sort of bravery and excitement of the whole thing. So it's very different. It was real sport. And they were driving lots of races a day. They were right out on the edge, as we know. It was furiously dangerous. So many drivers were getting killed. So it was an extraordinary time. And I'm absolutely sure that young enthusiasts they're not really aware of that. And this will certainly help them understand what it was all about and why there is such a huge excitement and involvement in the sport at that time. Well, I think, it needs to remain on the edge. That's important. And I think it's important F1 is a sort of top end of, absolute high end of technology. That's pretty important. And I think it just doesn't want to get too repetitive. They've got to find ways of changing it, making it more exciting, making it more equal, perhaps, and making sure that we have the very best talent out there driving. And that those really are those drivers that we see racing are the very best drivers in the world, driving the most extreme machinery.
I think it's so important to reflect on bygone eras, and to see how the sport's evolved through the decades. There was certainly something, golden is one way of describing it, but it was certainly a unique era in the sense of the danger, the jeopardy of it. Any time a driver got into the car, they risked their life. And that's astonishing to believe and to understand, comprehend how they were dicing with death on a weekly basis. I think that a lot of current drivers, current fans, feel that the sport has been sanitised to an extent, and that's not a bad thing. I'm always an advocate of safety. I think that's really important. I think that so many fans are drawn by the jeopardy of the sport, so I understand why. You know, if there's loads of runoff areas at each corner, they're going to feel like, come on, we want to see guys really fighting for it, and girls. But I don't think anyone could really understand what the drivers went through back then. I mean, I've sat in a couple of old cars and you are just blown away by the lack of, you know, you just got this dodgy old seatbelt and like no kind of, when you consider the structure of the cockpit nowadays and the safety measures that we're talking about, the halo coming in, there's such resistance to that, right, from so many fans. But you've got to understand that one death is one too many, and Jules Bianchi dying very recently was a stark reminder of just how dangerous motorsport can be. Ferrari is iconic. You simply can't imagine Formula One without them, and you can't really say that about another team. And I'm sure that is in no small part down to Enzo Ferrari, about this incredible determination, and many called him a dictator, in establishing this reverence for the car. You don't really feel that with any other team. And as a result, it's treated as a religion, not only in Italy, but worldwide. If you ever go to the Italian Grand Prix, the Tifosi are another level of passion. I mean, it's crazy. There's not a single F1 driver on the grid who wouldn't secretly like to drive for Ferrari at some point in their career. I don't think character's missing these days. I really don't. You know, from interviewing the drivers many times, I see a lot of strong personalities out there. I think things have changed. Commercialism and sponsorship is such that they feel somewhat shackled when they're in the paddock and the pit lane. They can't really necessarily express themselves in the same way. You certainly couldn't conduct yourselves the way James Hunt did, for example, in this day and age. You know, there's too much at stake. But so I think different elements of the sport are celebrated in different ways now. But certainly many of the drivers will tell you, looking back, the bravery, the tenacity of these guys was unparalleled.
In terms of our current season, obviously Lewis, four-time champion now, do you think that does make him the best ever? Or, I mean, because there's a debate. Obviously Michael's won more, but Lewis, you know.
I mean, he's without doubt the best British driver of all time, and that's just astonishing. Michael Schumacher's obviously a way off in terms of his win rate and his world championship titles. But Lewis is on course for him. He's still only 32, so who knows? He may well emulate the great Michael Schumacher yet.
I think obviously over the last few years we've seen, particularly with a lot of the changes in engine requirements and things coming in, it was designed to make the sport more competitive after a period of Red Bull dominance. Do you think that has worked out? Because I think initially fans were a little worried that all it had really done had shifted that dominance to Mercedes for a few years.
I think all these things are cyclical. Every team's going to hit a purple patch and run with it. I think that's inevitable. The other inevitability is the bigger the budget you've got, the more that you can, more resource that you can use. But I think we should take great heart from the likes of Force India, who are punching well above their weight, you know, secured their place as fourth in the constructors, and with very limited resource and budget. So it can be done, and I think actually this season's proved that Formula One's a thrilling place to be, and you know, edge of your seat stuff still. You know, all the critics, I believe, have been silenced. That amazing rivalry re-sparked between Ferrari and Mercedes this year. You just don't know what's going to happen from race to race. And even those big teams have suffered major reliability issues. It goes to show that no one's bulletproof.
The one question that each season we do keep asking is when we are going to see a female driver in Formula One, and why that maybe hasn't happened as quickly as I think people thought it might a few years ago. Do you have a feeling about when and if we are going to see women in Formula One and other top-tier motorsport?
I really believe it's just a matter of time, and I feel that there's nothing physical that precludes a woman from racing in F1. Many will say it's too physical for women. I just don't buy that. You know, maybe you need a stronger neck for G-force reasons, but, you know, we can all go to the gym and build up our neck muscles. At the end of the day, it's a perception thing, and I feel that women need to feel that the sport is accessible, and it's down to broadcasters like us at Sky to prove to girls that this is a sport where they've got a future. So the onus is on us to deliver that message, and there's really strong role models acting as trailblazers like Claire Williams, and there's young drivers coming through the ranks. I believe that as soon as the talent's there, we need to then give them the platform so that they can realise that dream that so many of us hold.